Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Poststructuralism, a Very Short Introduction by Catherine Belsey, narrated by Bernadette Dunne.
Chapter 1. Creatures of Difference. A Question of Meaning. When Lewis Carroll's Humpty Dumpty discusses the question of meaning with Alice in Through the Looking Glass, which of them is right? Humpty Dumpty engages Alice in one argument after another, just as if dialogue were a competition. Having demonstrated to his own satisfaction, if not Alice's, that unbirthday presents are to be preferred because people can have them more often, he adds triumphantly, "There's glory for you." Torn between the desire to placate him and good common sense, Alice rejoins, "I don't know what you mean by glory." So Humpty Dumpty explains, "I meant, there's a nice knockdown argument for you." "But glory doesn't mean a nice knockdown argument," Alice objected. "When I use a word," Humpty Dumpty said in a rather scornful tone, "it means just what I choose it to mean, neither more nor less." "The question is," said Alice, "whether you can make words mean so many different things." "The question is," said Humpty Dumpty, "which is to be master, that's all." Alice's skepticism is surely justified. Meaning is not at our disposal, or we could never communicate with others. We learn our native language, and in the process learn to invoke the meanings other people use. Small children find out from those who already know how to distinguish ducks from squirrels. Ducks are the ones that fly. And children make mistakes. Airplanes fly, but they are not ducks. Glory is not a nice knockdown argument. Language makes dialogue possible, but only on condition we use it appropriately, subscribing to the meanings already given in the language that always precedes our familiarity with it. As this exchange demonstrates, there is no such thing as a private language. Humpty Dumpty has to translate his before he can communicate with Alice. Language and Knowledge. Language, understood in the broad sense of the term to include all signifying systems, including images and symbols, gives us access to information. Command of a new knowledge very often amounts to learning the appropriate use of a new vocabulary and syntax. To the extent that anyone understands economics, they demonstrate the fact by using its terms and arranging them in the appropriate order. A grasp of psychoanalysis means the ability to exchange words such as unconscious, repression, or transference effectively. Mathematics, science, and logic have their own symbolic systems, and qualified practitioners of these disciplines know how to inhabit them. The examination system is above all a way of policing the profession, making sure that those who qualify to join it understand how its language or symbols are conventionally employed. Film directors and advertisers, meanwhile, know the meanings conveyed by pictures of vulnerable children or sleek sports cars. Language in this broad sense is also a source of social values. In learning to use words like democracy and dictatorship appropriately, for instance, Western children find out about political systems, but they also absorb, as they do so, the value their culture invests in these respective forms of government. For better or worse, Western children learn early on, without having to be explicitly taught, that dictatorship is oppressive and democracy so precious that it is worth fighting for. In many cultures, the flag is the visual indicator of a national identity that must be defended. By force, if necessary. Language and cultural change. If language, in other words, transmits the knowledges and values that constitute a culture, it follows that the existing meanings are not ours to command. And yet, is it possible that the disdainful Humpty Dumpty has a point after all? To reproduce existing meanings exactly is also to reaffirm the knowledges our culture takes for granted and the values that precede us, the norms, that is, of the previous generation. Examination papers in economics, mathematics, or film studies are set and marked by existing practitioners, experts in the field, whose job it is to mark down misunderstandings and misuses of the conventional vocabulary. In this sense, meanings control us, inculcate obedience to the discipline inscribed in them. And this is by no means purely institutional or confined to the educational process. A generation ago, campaigners for women's rights recognized, not for the first time, the degree to which woman meant domesticity, nurturing, dependence, and the ways in which anti-feminist jokes, for instance, reproduced the stereotypes of the helpless little girl or the aging harridan. The question feminists confronted was precisely who was to be master, as Humpty Dumpty puts it. In this particular case, however, his formulation was self-evidently not one we could adopt. The term master would hardly help the feminist cause, but mistress would not easily take its place, since it carried sexual connotations that detracted from the authority we were looking for. The right word in a new situation does not always readily present itself. Language sometimes seems to lead a life of its own. Words are unruly. "They've a temper, some of them," Humpty Dumpty goes on to observe. In this case, the masculine and feminine values were not symmetrical, and nor, of course, was the culture. Without supposing this was the only change necessary, we nonetheless set out to modify the language, annoying conservatives with coinages like chairperson and she/he. We refused to laugh at misogyny and ignored the taunts that we had no sense of humor. For a time, dialogue did indeed become the kind of competition Humpty Dumpty's conversation exemplifies. Perhaps, in a way, it always is. Language is not in any sense personal or private, but individuals can alter it as long as others adopt their changes. What, after all, do great poets, philosophers, and scientists do but change our vocabulary? Shakespeare invented hundreds of words. New disciplines do the same. In the course of the 20th century, science successively named electrons, protons, neutrons, and quarks. Poststructuralism is difficult to the extent that its practitioners use old words in unfamiliar ways, or coin terms to say what cannot be said otherwise. This new vocabulary still elicits some resistance, but the issue we confront is how far we should let the existing language impose limits on what it is possible to think. Poststructuralism and language. Poststructuralism names a theory or a group of theories concerning the relationship between human beings, the world, and the practice of making and reproducing meanings. On the one hand, poststructuralists affirm consciousness is not the origin of the language we speak and the images we recognize, so much as the product of the meanings we learn and reproduce. On the other hand, communication changes all the time, with or without intervention from us, and we can choose to intervene with a view to altering the meanings, which is to say, the norms and values our culture takes for granted. The question is just the one Humpty Dumpty poses. Who is to be in control? This very short introduction will trace some of the arguments that have led poststructuralists to challenge traditional theories of language and culture, and with them traditional accounts of what it is possible to know, as well as what it is to be a human being. Poststructuralism offers a controversial account of our place in the world, which competes with conventional explanations. The importance of language. Most of the time, the language we speak is barely visible to us. We are more concerned with what it can do. Buy us a train ticket. Persuade the neighbors to keep the noise down. Get us off the hook when we've done something wrong. And yet, few issues are more important in human life. After food and shelter, which are necessary for survival, language and its symbolic analogs exercise the most crucial determinations in our social relations, our thought processes, and our understanding of who and what we are. Even food and shelter do not come into our lives undefined. Menus that offer succulent corn-fed baby chicken drizzled with a tingling lemon sauce, probably take this principle to extremes, but for me, I remember Scrag and Stew was a lost cause from the beginning. Houses, too, are characterized in language, and not only by estate agents. We might want to live in one we could justifiably call old or quaint, modern or minimalist. But we might feel less enthusiastic once we had come to think of the same property as decrepit, pokey, brash, or bleak. Paint manufacturers know that we are more likely to coat our walls in a color marketed as morning sun than in one called custard, even when the pigmentation is exactly the same. In this sense, language intervenes between human beings and their world. There is a party game that involves blindfolding one player as a prelude to guessing what foods are placed on his or her tongue. Whether consciously or not, guessing means classifying in accordance with the system of differences the language already provides. Is it sweet or savory? Hot or cold? Bland or bitter? Poststructuralism proposes that the distinctions we make are not necessarily given by the world around us, but are instead produced by the symbolizing systems we learn. How else would we know the difference between pixies and gnomes? Or march hares and talking eggs like Humpty Dumpty come to that. But we learn our native tongue at such an early age that it seems transparent, a window onto a world of things, even if some of those things are in practice imaginary, no more than ideas of things derived from children's stories. Are ideas the source of meaning then? That was once the conventional view. But our ideas are not, poststructuralists believe, the origin of the language we speak. Indeed, the reverse is the case. Ideas are the effect of the meanings we learn and reproduce. We learned our idea of Humpty Dumpty, if we did, from nursery rhymes, Lewis Carroll, and John Tenniel, who illustrated the Alice books. In its account of how we become meaning animals and the role meaning plays in our understanding of the world, poststructuralism represents a modern challenge to traditional beliefs. Meaning. What is meaning? Where do meanings come from? Perhaps the question finds more focus in relation to a specific instance. What then does the word modern mean in the sentence at the end of the last section? What precise time span does modern cover? The answer seems to vary with the context. As a description of the post-structuralist challenge to inherited beliefs, it may mean nothing much more specific than new. Modern history, on the other hand, generally concerns the period since the 17th century. And yet we think of modern languages as distinct from the classical languages, while modern furniture almost certainly belongs to the 20th century or later. In these instances, modern defines no common chronological period. Modern history belongs to about the last 500 years, modern languages to perhaps the last 1,000, and modern furniture to no more than the last 100 or so. The modern challenge of poststructuralism itself is a product of the last few decades. The term modern, in other words, has no positive content, but owes its meaning to difference. What is modern in these instances is respectively not medieval, not ancient, not antique, or simply not traditional. But at least in all these cases, modern distinguishes a period that is more recent than another. Modernism, however, denoting a style in art and literature and associated with the first half of the 20th century, is probably no longer the latest thing, while in the compound postmodern, so widely used to define our own era, modernity has explicitly become, paradoxically, a thing of the past. Nevertheless, although it seems to refer to no fixed period, we are usually able to understand and use the word modern without difficulty. How? In the course in general linguistics first published in 1916, the Swiss linguist Ferdinand de Saussure proposed that in language, there are only differences without positive terms. And this observation initiated a train of thought that would be taken up by a succession of figures in a range of disciplines during the course of the following century. Poststructuralism begins with an account of how we are able to mean, and goes on to conceive of human beings as animals distinctively possessing and formed by this capability. We are, that is to say, creatures of difference. Meaning, Saussure proposed, did not depend on reference to the world or even to ideas. On the contrary, he argued that if the things or concepts language named already existed outside language, words would have exact equivalents from one language to another, and translation would therefore be easy. But as all translators know, nothing could be further from the truth. Toto sois sage, we dutifully intoned in my French class when I was 11. Toto be good. But even at that early stage, we sensed that sage and good were not always interchangeable. A good time, in French, we knew, would not be sage at all, since the term implied sense or wisdom. We were, in addition, using a mode of address that had no English translation. The second person singular that exists in so many European languages, tu, du, can cause native speakers of English endless embarrassment when we try to communicate in other tongues, since it carries connotations of intimacy or hierarchy that can cause offense if used inappropriately. Genders and tenses do not necessarily correspond from one language to another. The morning is masculine in French, le matin, feminine in Italian, la mattina. French has the past historic, a special tense for telling stories. Some languages include more than one plural form. Differences that are given in one language have to be mastered, often with difficulty, by those whose mother tongue divides up the world in another way. We are compelled to conclude either that some languages misrepresent the way things are, while our own describes the world accurately, or that language, which seems to name units given in nature, does not in practice depend on reference to things or even to our ideas of things. Instead, the units that seem to exist so unproblematically may be differentiated from one another by language itself, so that we think of them as natural, just as we may perceive the continuous spectrum of the rainbow in terms of seven distinct colors. A century ago, many European nations were ready to impose their own classifications on other cultures, where imperial conquest made this possible. But the multicultural societies that have resulted from the decline of empire are willing to be more generous in their recognition of other accounts of the world, which is to say, other networks of differences. A language represents a way of understanding the world, of differentiating between things and relating them to one another. The Kenyan writer Ngugi wa Thiong'o wrote his first works of fiction in English. Later, it came to seem to him that this practice conceded too much to the influence of the former colonial power and the continued economic and cultural neocolonialism of the West. However African the content and themes of his early novels, the novel itself was a European genre, its structure reproducing a Western pattern of thought. Moreover, the English language could not do justice to Kenyan perceptions of the world. He then began to write in Kikuyu, drawing on indigenous forms of narrative and drama. Difference, not reference. The simple inference that meaning is differential, not referential, has profound implications for our understanding of the relations between human beings and the world, and many of them remain controversial even now. The history of poststructuralism is the story of the way Saussure's ideas were taken up by later generations, especially in France, and particularly after the Second World War, when the history of National Socialism, and of French collaboration with it, seemed to demand an explanation that existing theories of culture were unable to provide. The key term in this story is difference. Saussure and the sign. Traditionally, words had been thought of as signs. The sign seemed to represent a presence that existed elsewhere, to stand as the sign of something. In everyday English, we still refer to the meaning behind the words, as if meaning existed somewhere on the other side of speech or writing. Saussure's work changed that. For him, meaning resides in the sign and nowhere else. In order to make the point clear, Saussure divided the sign in two. On the one hand, the signifier, the sound or the visual appearance of the word, phrase, or image in question. On the other, the signified, its meaning. In ordinary circumstances, the distinction is purely methodological. We rarely see a signifier which does not signify or mean something. But an unknown language consists entirely of signifiers in isolation. We hear sounds and assume that they signify, since we see native speakers apparently communicating, but to us they mean nothing. Or we see a page of impenetrable written characters. If you don't happen to know Greek, this is a pure signifier. Lambda, omicron, gamma, omicron, sigma. In its written form, it makes a shape. Spoken aloud, it makes a particular sound. Logos. And if you do know Greek, it brings with it a signified, which has no exact equivalent in English, but ranges between word, idea, meaning, and sense. Changing the shape very slightly and silently by capitalizing the initial letter, we turn it into logos and the signified changes to something like God or reason. Neither element of the sign determines the other. The signifier does not express the meaning, nor does the signified resemble the form or sound. On the contrary, the relationship between signifier and signified is arbitrary. There is nothing doggy about the word dog. There can't be, since the French recognize much the same characteristics in un chien. Even in languages with a shared European history, Schwein, Maiale, pork, and pig have more or less the same signified. Children learn to distinguish the meaning when they learn the signifier.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.